single explosion ripped through the desert horizon, tearing open the black curtain of oil smoke. For a few seconds, the sky glowed red, and then radar screens went blank. No distress call, no warning. Only a low, metallic rumble rolling across the dunes. The kind of sound that makes you wonder, was it thunder or something else? On Highway 80, a long convoy moved north, engines whispering through darkness. They thought the night would protect them. But from the west, two faint lights cut through the haze, slow, steady, unannounced. Not an F-15, not an F-117. This was something different, something designed not to outrun danger, but to live inside it. The A-10 Thunderbolt II, the Warthog. When the GAU-8/A Avenger spun to life, the desert didn't explode. It trembled. A line of molten light carved the darkness, faster than sound, sharper than silence. Then came the hum of twin TF-34 engines fading into the night. That night, the idea of air power changed forever. Speed no longer ruled. Precision did. And for those who survived, one name would echo through their memories. The Warthog. This is Titan Defense, where the secret blueprints of war are decoded, and the machines that shaped history finally speak. Every explosion begins with an idea, and the A-10 was born not from victory, but from failure. After the Vietnam War, the US Air Force faced a paradox. Supersonic jets could dominate the sky, yet struggled to survive the ground. What good is speed when every anti-air gun can bring you down? So they asked a question that felt almost heretical. What if slower meant stronger? In 1972, the Attack Experimental Program, AX, began. Fairchild Republic received one of the strangest design briefs in history. Build an aircraft that can fly low, take hits, and come back alive. The first sketches looked crude. Straight wings, bulky landing gear, twin engines sitting high like shoulders above a boxer's stance. But underneath that awkward frame was genius. Every angle calculated not for beauty, but for endurance. As the Cold War tightened its grip, another question rose in Washington. If thousands of armored vehicles ever crossed the German plains, could anyone stop them before they reached the Atlantic? That question gave birth to a purpose, an aircraft built to stay above the battlefield longer than fear itself. And so the A-10 was born, not to rule the skies, but to protect those beneath them. But to understand why it survived when others fell, we have to open the machine and study the logic of its armor, the intelligence hidden in its metal bones. They didn't draw a fighter. They drew a survivor. What makes a machine endure? Is it armor, redundancy, or the will of those who built it to face the impossible? The A-10's airframe is 95% high-stress aluminum alloy, flat riveted panels designed for field repair within hours. Its straight wings, dismissed as primitive, give unmatched lift and stability at near stall speeds, essential for flying low and slow with surgical precision. It can carry 16,000 pounds of external ordnance, AGM-65 Mavericks, GBU-12 Paveway 2, GBU-38 JDAMS, Hydra 70 and Zuni rockets, MK-82/84 bombs, AM-9 Sidewinders for aerial defense. Each of its 11 pylons can be reconfigured within minutes, modularity decades ahead of its time. Two TF-34 GE-100 turbofan engines rest high on the tail, shielded from heat-seeking sensors and battlefield debris. Each produces over 9,000 pounds of thrust, and they're spaced wide enough that even if one fails, the other still brings you home. That's redundancy, not luxury. The cockpit, a titanium bathtub weighing over 540 kilograms, encloses the pilot like a second skin. Its 1.5-inch armor deflects 23-millimeter shells and absorbs kinetic shock like a mechanical heartbeat. It's more than a shield. It's a memory of lessons written in blood. At the core lies the GAU-8/A Avenger, a 7-barrel, 30-millimeter rotary cannon stretching nearly 6 meters. The aircraft itself is balanced around its axis. It fires at 3,900 rounds per minute. Each round leaves the barrel at over Mach 3. Even the spent shells are recycled back into the drum, maintaining perfect weight symmetry. Was it over-engineered? Maybe. But in the A-10's logic, perfection isn't optional, it's survival. With Lightning or Sniper X R-pods, the Warthog detects thermal signatures, designates by laser, and strikes through dust, smoke, or storm. Its ECM suite, RWR sensors, and flare dispensers weave an invisible cocoon, a digital reflex that senses danger before the pilot does. The A-10 is ugly, yes, but its ugliness is deliberate, the kind that makes you stare and think, maybe survival has its own kind of beauty. While Fairchild built endurance, Sukhoi built urgency. In the same decade, across the Iron Curtain, engineers shaped the T-8 project, later known as the Su-25 Grach. Two designs, two doctrines, one purpose: control the low-altitude battlefield. If the A-10 believed in precision and persistence, the Su-25 believed in simplicity and speed. The 10 straight wings gave lift and endurance. Su-25's swept wings gave maneuverability. One relied on titanium and electronics, the other on compact armor and ease of repair. The American philosophy was redundancy, systems within systems. The Soviet philosophy was reliability. Fix it with tools, not computers. A 10 could return with half a wing missing. Su-25 could land with one landing gear intact. Two machines, each designed not for victory, but for survival. Both would prove themselves. But destiny chose the desert, not Europe, as the testing ground. And in 1991, that test began. South of Basra, a horizon flashing like broken glass. And then, silence. On radar, icons vanished one after another. A voice over the radio whispered three words: "The Warthogs are in." Two A-10s from the 76th Tactical Fighter Squadron descended below 300 meters. Oil fires cloaked the sky. Infrared sensors drowned in heat. It was chaos. And in chaos, the Warthog thrived. Flying just 480 kilometers per hour, they used the terrain itself as cover, a tactic called terrain masking, where hills and dunes hide your radar echo. Their AN/ARN-118 nav system pinpointed the convoy. A pilot adjusted the Pave pennypod, exhaled, and squeezed the trigger. The desert answered with one wordless sound: brrrt, a thunder that wasn't thunder. Each burst short, precise and final. At Mach 3, the tungsten rounds pierced steel like paper. Later analysis would show average deviation, 1.2 meters. Ground troops relayed coordinates via encrypted data link. AWACS aircraft integrated them, feeding real-time updates to the A-10's HUD. It was sensor fusion before the term even existed. When the engines finally eased off, the night went still again. Two A-10s turned west and disappeared beyond the border. Every one of them returned home. Fairchild's memo had proven prophetic. If it flies home, it wins. But as history would later ask, what happens when the world no longer fights the kind of wars this plane was built for? What truly won that night? Was it bravery or engineering? On paper, the A-10 was unstoppable. It could fly with one engine gone, a hydraulic system destroyed, even half a wing missing, and still land safely. Its dual-circuit hydraulics, manual reversion mode, and mechanical backups were a pilot's lifeline. The A-10C's lightning targeting pod detects targets beyond 12 kilometers. Its laser rangefinder guides precision munitions with sub-meter accuracy. In comparison, the Su-25's Glenn PS system reached just 7 kilometers and lacked autonomous laser guidance. That 5-kilometer gap? It's the difference between spotting first and being spotted. The GAU-8/A-Avengers dispersion was under 5 mils at 1,200 meters, meaning 80% of rounds hit within a 6-meter radius. The GSH-30-2 question was spicy. Precision versus saturation. Two philosophies. Speed? The Su-25 reached nearly 975 kilometers per hour. The A-10, barely 720. But at 200 meters altitude, speed is blindness. You can't hit what you can't see. And sometimes, the slower hunter is the deadlier one. By the 2000s, the A-10C evolved again, integrating Link 16 networks, digital CAS systems, and data sharing with AWACS, UAVs, and ground forces. While other aircraft sought stealth, the Warthog mastered awareness. It wasn't just a jet, it was a node in a living network of precision warfare. So ask again, was it outdated or simply irreplaceable? Three decades later, the Warthog still flies. Its paint chipped, its skin scarred, its purpose unchanged. Every time the radio crackles, Warthog on station, ground troops still breathe easier, because they know whatever's coming next won't reach them. The A-10 became more than an aircraft. It became a principle. That presence can be more powerful than fear. In a world of stealth bombers and quantum sensors, it whispers a quiet reminder: not every machine must disappear to be effective. The F-15EX learned quick maintenance from it. The F-35 inherited its situational awareness. The B-21 Raider borrowed its minimalism. All of them, in one way or another, carry the Warthog's DNA. Yet no successor has matched its bond with the human inside. Pilots spoke of hearing its tone, the subtle hum of metal before a stall, the faint vibration before recoil. Those instincts saved lives. Machines can calculate trajectories, but only humans can decide when not to pull the trigger. And as the A-10 nears retirement, it leaves behind more than sound. It leaves a philosophy. Efficiency over elegance. Survival over speed. Humanity over machinery. Even in an era ruled by AI and autonomy, the sky still needs a heartbeat. And somewhere, above an empty desert or a forgotten airfield, that heartbeat still echoes, low, metallic, timeless, brrrt. Not the sound of war, but the reminder that true strength is measured not by destruction, but by endurance. This is Titan Defense, where classified files are unsealed, where technology meets strategy in the light of truth, and where the sky still remembers, even when the world chooses to forget.